So our presentation today is called Path to Greater Mine Profitability, 21st Century Relining. As you're probably all aware, we are about mill relining. Most of the people in the room are probably worried about mills when they're turning. We worry about them when they stop turning and try to get them turning again as quickly as possible. We're going to begin, there's basically three major parts to this presentation. We're going to be looking, first of all, and John's going to be talking about an innovative approach to mill relining, different strategy, way of approaching relining. I guess the major way that people have thought about relining in the past is about reducing downtime. What John's going to talk about is something that also will help with the throughput of the mine. So we'll begin with that. Then we're going to go through some of the safety technologies that we've developed very recently, and then some of the performance technologies around mill relining. So I'm going to hand over to John, who's going to give the first part of the presentation.
Thanks, Peter. Mill lines are interesting things. They've got two functions. Their primary function is to protect the mill shell from abrasive wear. So the sacrificial they're wearing away all the time. But the other aspect is it's where the line of profile is where the installed power of the mill actually engages the charge. When RME first kicked off, the premise wasn't about the second, it was about the first. It was the line of life. And the observation was that line of life dictated shutdown sequences, and the time that it took to exchange those liners dictated the length of the shutdown. So numbers of shutdowns times length of shutdown is part of availability and plant utilisation. So the vision was to shrink the time that it took to take relines, because most other jobs in the concentrator weren't in series. They weren't in confined spaces, they didn't have limits. If you get the reline time down, then you can double the number of pump crews. So pumps don't take 4 to 6 hours to change the guts. So you can have parallel crews and change all the pumps in 4 to 6 hours and you have enough crews. So that was the vision. And we played like that for 1990 with the first machine, through to about 2005, I suppose. And the additional thinking came from a casual conversation with a metallurgist at Cadia. We're down there at a reliner commissioning machine. And just in passing, this metallurgist said, "Oh, back to 1650 tonne an hour tomorrow." This is towards the end of the reline. And I said, "What do you mean?" And he said, "Oh, every time we put new liners in the sag mill, it's a 40-foot mill. We go back to 1650 tonne an hour." And I said, "From what?" He said, "Oh, 2250. Well, that was 77% of peak. And it caught my ear. And so just casually, I started asking around about it, and we had a guy working in South America for us at the time, he used to work for F.L. Schmidt, he commissioned the Candelaria concentrator, things like that, he was a metallurgist. I said to this guy, "I've heard that, you know, when you put new liners in the mill, the production rate goes down." He said, "Oh yes, typical, 80%. So I started giving papers on this concept that if you had more less aggressive liners, shall we say, and changed more frequently, so you put in liners that look like half-worn out liners, but you change them more frequently, then there was a productivity gain. I'm going to have a series of papers on that every 6 months. And you start at this low point, climb to a peak, and then as they start to lose their lift, they do fade away a touch. The vision was that if you change the liners every 3 months, then you get the shaded area in extra production. It looked like it was about 5%, 5 to 5%. But I gave that paper in various formats, still through Times, and the lack of traction or interest in it, I stopped giving it actually, so I thought, I'm probably out of my depth here. And the audience is probably thinking, "Oh, John's a nice guy, he's great at making neural machines," but so as metallurgy goes, that wasn't so good, so I stopped giving them. Fortunately, Rob Morrison is not still tied up with the joke,
right?
Yeah. He picked up on it and thought he'd follow it. And a fellow called Paul Tor actually started doing some formal research. Was it his master's?
Yeah.
And he He worked at the mill that he used for his studies, it's the 32-foot sag mill at Cadia, the Ridgeway plant. And yeah, at the end of that, he concluded that indeed there was a benefit to be had, more tons throughput. He also found that there could there was a promise of, or the indication of, lower kilowatt hours per tonne. It had everything going for it. And I'm no metallurgist, but I imagine at least two of the mechanisms that help more throughput with thinner liners is an increase in mill volume. Maybe the Cadia mill, if you've got liners that are 600 mil deep, and that's pretty common, the Larry lifters, they used to call them, certainly that sort of depth. So your 40-foot mill is really a 36-foot mill, so there's a volume thing going on. But also, as the liners wear and they lose the profile, you can actually touch up the speed a bit without the balls throwing beyond the toe of the charge. And in all sort of wear and braided situations, an increase in velocity, a sliding velocity, as far as fine particles creation goes or abrasion, is some of the third or fourth power, I think, of going back to abrasion. So I think that's a second mechanism going. As they can tweak up the mill from maybe 81% to 83% critical, there's an increasing, a minor increase in sliding velocity of the charge, which might contribute to it as well. Anyway, it looked promising. And then picked up again and did some further work and created more of an economic model, which took into account relining performance. And he studied it as a measure, but basically it once again supported, instead of doing one reline every 6 months as per the data, two or three relines every 6 months had productivity gains. The different coloured lines had to do with relining performance, whether you're doing 60 hours, 50 hours, 40 hours. So clearly, lots of relines done quickly so you don't lose too much one of our little time has got this benefit. But still, we're here with our customers, and these are customers that our customers tend to be the bigger mine sites, the blue chip miners, and their big plants, and the better half of the second tier. The normal conversation is a determined thrust to reduce the number of relines. So we're not involved with their metallurgical discussions, but certainly the maintenance folk are driving towards, their dream is one reline a year. The only way to get there, presumably, is ever think of liners, because no one's invented unobtainium yet to make liners that last forever. So they're clearly driving towards heavier liners, so the thought is fewer relines. And you've got to ask the question, why would people want to do fewer relines when they shut the plant down for other reasons anyway? And it's, the only conclusion we can come to is fear. Fear of the hazards, because it's clearly the most hazardous maintenance task of the concentrator, which Peter will address. And unpredictability. You're hot branding these reline crews and they're great characters. And they're expected to take responsibility for a plant that can generate revenues of sort of $1,000, $2,000, $3,000, $5,000 an hour. And it's an unpredictable task, relining. So there's lots of reasons for people to fear relining. So a lot of the work in the last couple of years towards these advanced technologies, not only are pursuing more safety for the crew and more performance, shorter relines, our vision is that these technologies in combination will actually take away the fear. So once you can take away the fear, then you can do more relines and start actually getting into this place of maybe reliners every 3 months rather than every 6 months, which is pretty common practice. So without any further ado, I'll hand over to Peter. Peter's been chief engineer at RME effectively for a long time. And the last couple of years, he's led an explosion in innovation at RME. With the technology group on one hand, which is engineers and computer IT people, and an industrial group, and the normal engineers themselves. So, it's been an interesting couple of years at RME, and what Peter present now is a condensation of the last couple of years' work and what this looks like for the future. Thank you. Thanks.
as John said, realigning, and everybody in the room would know, realigning mills, grinding mills is dangerous. It's an area that a space that's quite full of hazards. It's a confined space to start with. You have to, often they're required to work at height when placing liners. They work walking on uneven ground, uneven balls, ball charge. Ball charge times can explode. They're working in close proximity to heavy machinery, often in close proximity to suspended loads. It's a horrible environment. It can be quite hot inside, humid, the glasses fog up when you enter the mill. And if that's not enough, sometimes balls and rocks get hung up in the liners and can fall on your head. So it's a hazardous environment. And the first grouping of technologies that I want to go through this morning is some of the safety technologies that we've developed recently. The number of technologies that have been developed have come about because of a significant investment that was made a couple of years ago in a research facility at our headquarters in Toowoomba. It consists of a mill relaying machine. We bought back one of the older machines when the customer was upgrading their machine, and we refurbished it. So we have our own mill relaying machine. We built a segment of a 40-foot mill, so it's a 30-degree segment of a 40-foot mill. And we put tie down sufficient to take the uplift of any of the machines that we manufacture. And it also has a prototype of the Skyway, which I'll discuss a bit later on. But this has been terrific for us because in the past, when we've wanted to develop a new technology, we've had to find a friendly mine, we've had to find a friendly reline crew that are willing to disrupt the reline by trying something new. And that's always difficult. It's a very high-pressure environment, very difficult to get conclusive results. So this has allowed our engineers to get up close and personal with relining, albeit in a fairly controlled environment. But it's allowed them to really see things in use, and we've been able to, there's been a lot of development come about as a result of this. We've been demonstrating this to customers over the last 2 years with very good results, contributing to the feedback on the technologies and also helping us to get those technologies out into the mines. So the first safety technology, which is an unusual one to start with when talking about safety, it's a rescue tube. Inside the mill, it's a confined space, and the only way to get out is out via the beam. Now, if somebody's injured inside the mill, which does happen, the first thing that happens is you preserve the site. So the reline machine is switched off, and you've got to get a person from the charge out of the mill. So this simple hoist system can be erected by a single person. There's a socket on the machine that this fits into. It can be erected in a few minutes and allows somebody to be rescued from the inside of the mill without further hazards being created. And this is the production version. It's contained in a box with a smash to access key so that you can unlock the box and you can guarantee that all the bits are there when it comes to, when it's actually needed. This next grouping of technologies are about being seen and being able to see. And the inside of the mill is illuminated usually by the reline machine lights, and they're generally focused on the area where the work is taking place. But there's a lot of other areas where work's happening and transit's happening with inside the mill, and there's very low lighting quite often. So our first thing we've been developing and been testing and trialling is a very high power but very diffused light. This light, when we've trialled it inside a 40-foot mill, provides better illumination than we've had in the past, and brings it up to the thresholds of where it conforms with the requirements of safe work. And the beauty of this light is that it's even though it's an extremely powerful light, it's very, very diffused and it's very large diameter, so it doesn't cast a sharp shadow. So when somebody's working, the shadow that's cast around them is quite diffused, and they are able to still see quite well, regardless of the brightness of the light. So this, we've trialled this in a 44 mil, as I said. We are recommending that there's two of these generally used within a mil. And you may have seen this type of light before, but they're not suitable for use in a confined space. So what we've done is develop a very low voltage version of it that's able to be safely used in a confined space. Another part of being seen is a camera system that's now installed on every one of our machines, which provides visibility around the machine, or areas that may not be visible to the operator. And there's two cameras that make up the system, one that is on the opposite side of the beam and one that looks to the rear of the machine, and we call that our RME-I. And that's all very well, both of those are still relying on people being alert and seeing what's going on. And what we have also on our machines now, or developed for our machines, is a proximity system that's been used for a long time in underground mines to detect the presence of people around heavy machinery. And we've developed adapted this to our reline machines. Everyone entering the mill has a tag that is either inserted on their helmet or carried on their vest. And on the machine, there's a generator that generates a magnetic field. When the person's in a warning zone, the machine slows down. Detects their presence, and then when it gets into a close proximity and a danger area, it stops the machine. And so this provides another layer of protection to the people that are in the mill. When we used this in the first instance in an actual mine during a reline, we were concerned that it would be disruptive to the reline, because often reliners have to get close to the machine during the relining process. The reliners themselves commented that they felt safer. They actually felt like they had some control over their own safety, and most of the work processes could be adapted to be used with it in operation. Those that couldn't have now added another feature that allows the machine to do fine movements while they're in that confined close zone. Another CNBC product is one that allows people on the outside of the mill to see what's happening on the inside. The mill itself creates a shield to being able to see what's going on. If a manager or a on-site safety personnel want to see what's going on inside the mill, they then have to enter the mill, which is entering a dangerous area. What this system is, and it mounts to the lights, in the front of the lights. And it's two cameras that provide full view of the inside of the mill, and that's projected to a screen on the outside of the mill, giving the managers or safety personnel or the reliners. What we found in the first installation we put into this, the reliners themselves actually liked it because they could see what was going on the inside of the mill. And that's the screen on the outside of the mill. So that's products about being seen and being able to see. Entry into the mill has been a hazardous area as well. So you go from being on a fairly safe platform outside the mill, go through the entry sometimes on your hands and knees. When you get through the mill, you're standing up, you immediately stand up and you're on a beam that may be 2 to 3 meters above the charge. And so what we're supplying with our machines now is what we call a safety portal. And once the machine's installed in the mill, this portal is brought in on the lining car, pinned in the position, and it projects through to the inside of the mill. There's a cable that goes on that and allows the reliners to be harnessed on as they make that transition through, before they transition onto the ladder that goes down onto the charge or onto the harness onto the mill reline machine to get onto the mill reline machine. And it also provides a rigid platform for the lights and the camera system. that's our safety portal. For the twin machines, we also have a device for enabling the reliners to get safely up to the machine. And it's a post system that clips onto a trolley and allows them to walk safely out to the machine and remove it and put it onto the turntable. We have lots of solutions for accessing the charge from the beam, as simple as a ladder through to what we call our ship stairs, which provide a more substantial access point. A few years ago, we engaged a gentleman on a full-time basis who his name's Wayne Herbertson. He's a leader in safety in the mining industry. Wrote a book on zero harm, and he's been busy over the last 2 years. RME export, we have about 360 mine sites that we work on around the world, and in about 56 different countries. And there's a variation of standards all around the world. We have to comply with everything from the Crane Code in Australia through to the Machinery Directives, the NC Directives in Europe, and standards in Russia. And so he spent time creating a database that harmonises all of those standards for us and extracts what's appropriate for our relining machines. And then he's done interviews and thorough analysis of all the hazards associated with relining, and then he's mapped those together and created a relining standard for us, which provides a very strong basis for the training of our crews and also something that we can use to work with the mines to provide the same level of safety. As John said, we have our own relining crew now.
For 30 years, RME's invented, designed, manufactured mill relining technologies, but today we've also got our own relining crew. All mill relining crews are faced with the same problems. They've got a contract to reline a mill, and within a certain period. The goal of mechanising relining was to take out the physical labour, the heavy physical labour, so the guys weren't so tired. At RME, we can train our own crews to a high level of proficiency with our training and research facility.
What we're doing is we're pulling that variability out of the mill to make them more efficient with better training. So we want to be able to train them in those things that can happen, so when they see it, they can actually know how to handle it and they deal with it so much more succinctly.
And that crew has been very beneficial to us in giving feedback directly on the things that we develop. And as we're testing things, it's really helped with the development of a lot of this equipment as well. So now we move on to the exciting bit. All those things are really good, but they address the way that relines are currently done, trying to lift the safety of current relining practices. What we really want to do is change the way relining is done. We want to get people out of the mill. That's the only real way that relining can be made completely safe. And so what we've got now is some technologies, and we call them the RME's Inside Out technologies. And it's about getting people out of the mill. There's two major reasons why reliners have to be inside the mill. One's to install the liners, and one's to remove the liners. And so we have an inside out liner placement and inside out liner removal. Now the tasks, I'm not sure how familiar are people with relining here? If you've got good familiarity, can you just give me an indication? If you don't understand relining at all, can you let me know? Okay, yeah, right. So when liner is being placed in the mill, this is a fairly typical picture of what's happening. The reline machine has picked up the liner. The liners are on the wall there. The machine's picked up the liner. It's placing it into position, but the operator who's sitting on the machine can't see precisely whether the holes are aligned or not. So he relies on these gentlemen standing around the liner, peering through the holes, shouting commands back, and giving them the fine adjustments to get the liner into position. Once it's been in position, then they are required to put the bolt through the liner and then the nuts added to the liner on the outside securing the liner into position.
So they have to be in close proximity to this, to the machine during this operation. So the first element of getting them out of the mill is being able to give direction to the operator. So we've found that the having an operator on the outside of the mill with a good headset and communication system that can talk to the operator is able to give as good, if not better, instruction to the four liner placement as somebody inside the mill. On the inside of the mill, you're at least the depth of the liner away from the hole, and probably a lot more. On the outside of the mill, you're only 100 mil from where they're coming together. So it's a simple change, but it allows that operation to be taken outside. When we've changed this process and working not with our own crew, but another crew offshore, they were able to achieve the same sorts of results that we were getting in our R&D facility. Fairly simple change, but it removes that task from the mill. The second part of the equation is getting the bolts into the liners or through the liners. And we have a patented technology that, again, is quite simple. But what it allows is the bolt to be put into the liner outside the mill, and it's secured in there so that it can't fall out, and it can't be dislodged when it's being bounced around by the forklift getting it into the mill. It's secure in there, but with a shock, a slight shock, it can be, a mechanical shock, it can be dislodged easily and then pulled through. So the liners are generally arranged outside the mill before placement. The bolts are inserted into them using this adapter that's quite simply attached to the end of the bolt. And the liners are picked up, placed on the liner gun, taken in, picked up by the machine, placed against the shell. Once they're aligned, there's a device, and this is the manual device, which is what we're starting with before we go to a more automated approach. And it's attached to the end of the bolt, into the same device that's holding it in there. And it acts a bit as a slide hammer, which knocks the bolt, releases it, pulls it through the shell, and then the nut is actually on that sunning tool, and it's spun directly onto the end of the bolt, where it can then be tensioned. So it's a simple approach, but it allows those activities that require somebody to be inside the mill to be outside the mill. Again, we've used this full system in an actual reline offshore with crew that we trained, and they were able to achieve 4-minute placement cycles after one inching cycle, which is very comparable to the, if not better than, the traditional approach. That's inside out placement on the shell and on the feed that can be used. On the discharge end, there's other tooling that's required, and we've been using and developing lots of different tooling for that. One of the things that is difficult for the guy to communicate is the angle of the liner. So when you're looking through the hole, you can see the position quite accurately, but you can't necessarily see the orientation of the liner. And so we have this little device that we call Eclipse, and it's a very simple device, magnetically attached to the outside of the mill in line in the line of the bolts. It's measuring the angle of the bolt, and there's another device with a display on it that's attached to the liner or integrated with the grapple. And they're communicating to each other, and it just gives a very simple visual feedback to the operator when he actually has that liner precisely aligned in that axis. The crew that we first used it with didn't want to give it back because it was actually very beneficial for even traditional placement methods. So the second part of the equation is getting people out of the mill when you're removing liners. And this is a fairly typical view of the inside of a mill after the liners have been knocked in. Now, the way liners are knocked in is the nuts are taken off, and then thunderbolt hammers or other hammers are used to knock the bolts into the mill. When you're knocking the bolts in and they release, they become a projectile. They'll shoot right across the mill, bounce off and bounce back again. They become a bullet. So you can't have people inside the mill. So the method that's developed and evolved is because of that is that when it comes to removing the liners, you get your crew all around the mill and you knock as many liners in as you can while nobody's in there. And then once all the knocking in is finished, you can then get into the mill and sling the liners out. So they have to put slings around the liners or use some of our ozone tools to engage the liners. Sometimes liners are stuck on the wall still, so they have to be levered down, which is very dangerous. And all of this is done with somebody clambering over these liners. So the approach that we're promoting and that we would like the industry to move towards is taking the liners directly from the shell. So at the moment, because they're knocked into the mill, you start with them in a very orderly position on the shell, and then suddenly you create the spaghetti on the floor, which has got to be untangled. So we're promoting that they should be taken directly from the wall. First thing you've got to do is get people, the operator, out of the mill, because you're going to be knocking that line from the outside still. So our technology group worked to what we on this product that we call VUE, Virtual U. And it's what we're trying to do is create as real an environment for the operator outside the mill as he would have if he was inside the mill. So we started working with VR headsets, commercially available. Everybody here would have used a virtual reality headset at some stage. And you probably noticed there's they call it screen door effect, because it's quite pixelated. Those are very, very low resolution screens, and they're no good. We found they were no good at all for creating that virtual presence and for doing fine machine control. So the technology group began looking at all different cameras, different screen sizes and resolutions that they could, and came up with this device that we call RME View. So it consists of a gimbal that you can see the camera in there, the two stereo cameras, that tracks the head of the operator. You can see it there on the machine. And the operator's seated outside the mill, and he has a very, very high quality, it's about half the resolution of your eye, very, very high quality view of what's going on with very, very good depth perception. That's the footage from just one of the cameras. Obviously it's not stereo on the screen. But he's able to get a very, very good view of what's going on, and we've found that the operators can very quickly learn to, this is being used for liner placement, but it's being developed predominantly for liner removal to get the operator out of the mill. But we found that it has achieved what we were wanting. And so the first part of getting liners out without somebody in the mill is get the operator out, which we were able to do with this device. The next part is about engaging the liner. So somehow, if you're going to be taking the liner from the wall, it's been worn for 3 to 6 months, and it has no features on it to grab a hold of. And so again, it's quite a simple device, is a sleeve that's fitted to the end of the bolt. We call it the Steve sleeve, because it's Steve Waters that thought of the idea. The nut's removed, the washer's removed, and this sleeve is added to the end of the bolt. And it increases the diameter enough that it can still fit through the mill shell hole, but it doesn't fit through the hole that's in the back of the liner. And what we found is, with a few hits of the Thunderbolt hammer knocking it through, it swages the bolt into the liner, and that swages the collar into the liner, and it provides two handles on the inside using the head of the bolt to grip the liner and remove it. Here you can see after it's been dislodged, you can see the head of the bolt. This is on our our leaf assembly, obviously. And we've been able to repeatedly do this, and it allows the liners to be taken directly from the mill shell. For the discharge end, we've developed various tools. This is a static tool that's able to engage the pulp lifters and the grates without anybody having to sling them. We're also working on some powered tools for that same activity. So our safety technologies are all about getting people out of the mill, or about making the current relining practices safe, but ultimately about getting people out of the mill. And this is where it starts to get even more exciting, because once you've got people out of the mill, then a whole lot of other things open up to you. At the moment, if you told reliners to go faster, the first thing they'd say is, no, it makes it more unsafe. It increases the hazards if I go faster. So there's no argument that can be made for speeding up the relining process. Once you have removed people from the mill, and some of these are dependent on that, but others aren't, you are able to increase performance. So the three things I just want to close with fairly quickly, because we're running out of time, is our Thunderbolt Skyway, which we have the prototype of it at our R&D facility, and we're currently manufacturing the first unit for a customer. Briefly about lean one-piece flow, which is about changing the process around relining, and then also about automation of the mill reline machine itself. So Thunderbolt Skyway is a technology that allows, that makes available a platform that can access the full 30-degree segment, 40-foot mill. It's the platform module. We call it Skyway because both of the modules are attached to a beam that's suspended above the mill. Everybody who's had anything to do with mine sites know that there's often obstructions around the floor, and around especially around the feed and discharge end. There's a lot of obstruction even to the bearing itself, and to have something that's floor mounted has always been very difficult for us. And so having this rail around the top, where a space that's not usually occupied by anything, allows us to have these modules that are able to access and work their way around any obstacle. So there's a platform module and also a Thunderbolt hammer module. This just shows the platform. Thunderbolt module. The Thunderbolt is semi-automated, so it automatically aligns with the bolts, but it's initiated. It's by the flick of the joystick. The operator tells it to go to the next bolt. It goes to the next bolt, automatically aligns, and it's able to push with a 500 kilo force as well as deliver a 1500 joule blow to the bolt. That extra force is very useful when you've got a liner that's maybe just sitting in the cradle, so it's in the lower half of the mill, and when you're impacting it with the hammer, it can just bounce sometimes. That allows you to push it off the wall. So that's our Thunderbolt Skyway. That's a very significant product for us at the moment. We're delivering our first commercial installation probably later in the year for a full system. And this is what it looks like as a full system around a 40-foot sag mill. With hammers and platforms in each of the six relining zones. We're very keen, and we've been promoting for a few years now, that reliners change the way that relining is done. I don't know how many here would be familiar with lean manufacturing. Lean manufacturing, or the Toyota production system, has transformed manufacturing. It's changed manufacturing from being based around creating batches of things to focusing on one item at a time, one unit at a time. They call it one-piece flow or single-piece flow. And we probably don't have time this morning to go through the details of that, but RME implemented lean one-piece flow in our manufacturing. And at the peak of the boom, it allowed us to manufacture a bespoke mill relining machine system every 7 days. And it just, and at a much higher quality, from a very high quality base, it provided us even a greater quality. And so with lean one-piece flow, if we're applying that to relining, what it means is instead of doing that batch knock-in of all the liners, if you were to approach it by taking one liner at a time and focusing on that one liner at a time, you would achieve the same sorts of benefits, because what it does, it makes all of the problems very visible and you work really hard to fix all the problems. It's a very counterintuitive approach. But the technologies around inside out allow this to take place, and we believe that there's going to be tremendous benefit as far as consistency and reline times are concerned by doing that. With this this approach, one liner is knocked into the mill, engaged by the machine, and then placed on the liner cart, and the same with when liners are being placed. Just by applying that simple philosophy of looking at one at a time and letting all the problems be real problems, it's surprising the transformation that takes place. There's multiple benefits to doing it this way. You get more consistent, the workload and the roles are more consistent. You have reduced crew sizes. People become very practiced at what they do. It makes all the problems very visible. You can standardize, which you can't at the moment when you've got spaghetti on the inside of the mill. It takes tremendous skill to get it out. And it will provide more consistent relines. And so finally, the other, and this is just one slide, but this is probably one of the more significant things that you will see start to come out over the next year or two in mill relining. And once people have adopted some of these inside-out technologies where people have been taken outside of the mill, we've started doing our testing with automated mill relining machines, and automating the functions of them to be able to go from a liner pickup through to placement and back again. And what that can only happen once you've got people outside the mill. We have a simulation program which we call Mill Reline Director that simulates relines down at the very very discrete level, at the task level. And when we've run single piece flow with semi-automated relines using our standard time and frequency distributions for all the non-automated tasks, but then just assigning machine speeds to the tasks that are currently done by humans, the numbers come out, and this is still allowing for quite long inching times and oxy-lancing per inch, per cycle, just because we can. And it's suggesting that 24-hour relines are possible for a standard reline, for a highway reline, and 40-hour relines for full relines. This is in a large 40-foot sag mill. So once you start getting to the point where the relines are safe, predictable, and it's not a major shutdown to do a reline, then suddenly the world opens up to what John was talking about, where you can think about relining not just in terms of downtime, but in terms of another way in which you can tune the performance of the segment. And so that's the presentation this morning, and I think